So my first question, as you know, I'm an immigrant from South Africa, came to this remarkable country in 1976, a country where no dream is too big for Americans. And my question to you is, what brought you to the United States? But more important, what gave you the idea to start a company? Tell me about SprintRay and what motivated you to do it. Well, first, tell us a little bit about your journey and how you became an entrepreneur.
First off, thank you, Stan. It's a pleasure to meet you and pleasure to be here. And also good to see you in good health. It's been a roller coaster of a year, and had it not been because of the pandemic, I was in person meeting you and shaking your hand. I'm an immigrant like many other people in this country, and I was born and grew up in Tehran, Iran. And with all the rights, benefits, and limitations you get from a from that country. And it was growing up was chasing football, and or here we call it soccer ball. I was always had this passion for disassembling parts and disassembling devices to see what's going on. And that led me going to the engineering school, where I did my undergrad in mechanical engineering. And after graduation, American dream was big. I would always give credit to Hollywood for really showing us what the American dream is. And that's when I started to apply for top universities in America to apply for my postgraduate studies. And I was lucky to get an admission from University of Southern California. And I landed an admission for my master's and later in my PhD. This was 2012. And I came to Los Angeles. So then after that, I was, the research group that I joined was being run at the time by a gentleman, very visionary, who became my first mentor, Professor Baruch Kushnevis. And he was, we call him Leonardo da Vinci of 3D printing. He had a lot of ideas and passion and patents and inventions that really was contagious and got us thinking about this. And at the time, his research got attention from NASA to use his technology for robotic construction of 3D printing of buildings, to use them to do construction on the surface of the moon. And here I am. I came from Iran, joined this school, and all of a sudden I'm working in a research group that is being essentially sponsored by NASA. It was very exciting, Stan, to be exposed to that level of, advancement, that level of excitement that was going on that really took an impact on me. And I learned two things. The first one was during those time was everything we do has to be application specific. So this became the foundation. At the time, we were focused on 3D printing of houses for the NASA projects, and then later, the focus became dentistry. The second thing that we learned was everything I want to do has to be transformational, has to hit and impact many, many lives. And this all manifested itself into putting a dream, setting up a vision, and later meeting the right people along the road.
That's amazing. My mentor also was at a university. His name was Dr. Edward B. Shills. He was the founder of the very first Center for Entrepreneurial Studies, which happened to be in the University of Pennsylvania. But he also was the executive director of the Dental Manufacturers of America. This was before the Dental Trade Alliance. They merged, several of these organizations merged, but he used to be a supporter of entrepreneurs, of small business people. And what he used to say to me is, entrepreneurship is about dealing with ambiguity. You know, if it's all clear, people are going to do it. It's about having a vision and getting through all of this with ambiguity. He never told me that it should be transformational. But, you know, the more I think of it now, 40 years after I met him, is that if you really want to make an impact, you got to transform. But I think that is something... you got to have a transformational idea. I actually think that that's something of your generation, where the generation is committed to making something big happen. I think it started in Silicon Valley. In my world, if you can make it just a little bit better, you were on the way to success. But the story of the United States in the last decade and a half, emanating from California, is transformation. Big ideas. And can't wait to hear or to see what is going to happen to your ideas 15 years from now. Because you got to start small, and then something big is going to happen. And you know what I've also learned is roadmaps are good, but it's the serendipity, what you bump into. And entrepreneurship and success is where opportunity meets preparedness. Bring them together.
Absolutely.
So where is this going to go?
To me, to talk about that entrepreneurship, the toughest thing or the crux of it is dealing with uncertainty, as you mentioned. And I always say, it's like flying an airplane and you only have one engine. And while you're flying it, you're building the second engine. And some of the toughest things to me is always making decisions with all of those uncertainties that you know some of them might actually crash the plane, but you have to do it because you know you don't have any other choice.
Right, absolutely.
That has been some of the toughest things and decision makings. And in terms of what's coming, in reality, back to the transformational, this is how I see it, Stan. 4 years ago, I was in the Chicago dental meeting, and we literally had to beg doctors to look at 3D printing. They had no idea what it was. After 4 years, we're talking about printing night guards. We're talking about doing things, printing crowns, creating things in a dental office that is very relevant. I watched one of your videos when you were talking about digitalization and as a part of one mega trend. 10 years from now, the way I dream it, every dental office have these manufacturer units, and they're able to manufacture parts customized to the patients. These are crowns, bridges, dental models. Before the patient even walks in, we will be able using AI to even predict what the patient needs. And this is how I see it happen.
Well, you know what's going to be interesting is for us to work together. We have software. And in that software, we are storing imaging from the X-ray image, but also the digital prosthetic. It's in the machine. Now, that data is owned really by the practice. But we can go to the practice and say, tell us who in your database needs procedure XYZ. You got the image. Connect with you and you can prepare the actual prosthetic. What do you think of that?
Yes.
So we have a scan.
Definitely.
We have a scan or an image, photograph image. You put them in the database. Then it's stored. Then you run through AI a scan. You say who in that system needs a crown or an aligner, and
the system will be able to predict and even automate a lot of even clinical aspects of it to actually produce the parts.
And you produce the parts.
And absolutely, this is what will happen. And Stan, I wanted to ask you about the effect of pandemic. I think it's a topic these days. How do you see that on the dentistry?
Well, I mean, there's the obvious is infection control, right? That's a big thing. The very good news that dentists from 1986 or 586, when it was alleged around that time for the first time that a patient had contracted AIDS, a dentist had contracted AIDS from a patient. From that moment on, dentists were very careful. So I think they led the healthcare professions in infection control. So that area, of course, is a big-time area, and lots is going to happen. And there's opportunity for all sorts of inventions around that. But I also think the notion that people don't want to go to the dentist for multiple visits, if they can do it once, they rather spend a little extra time, they rather spend a bit more, but they want to go into the dentist, get all over in one visit, because every visit is somewhat of a risk, although it's not really, but it's in the patient's mind. So this is where I think you come in. you prepare quicker, easier, and more digitalized dentistry, and it's a home run.
Absolutely, 100%. And the way we saw it from our lens is this vertical integration, the ability to be in control of fabrication in the office, that really resonated more and more and became relevant after the pandemic. One part of it, as you mentioned, is infection control. When they produce parts, they know how many hands have touched them. They know that cross-contamination will not happen.
Right.
And on top of that, the ability to provide a single visit appliances, reducing it 100% is something that will be more and more relevant.
Right. So what I think, you know, I think the products you got are great. That's fantastic. You'll create a market share. But use your knowledge that you gained from dentistry. You got John as well on your team. He knows the stuff.
Sure.
Use your knowledge. Use your entrepreneurial mind and think of the next frontier, if you will. And don't be shy. Let your mind wander. You got your today product, but your imagination tomorrow. That's what I would do with your background, your imagination, your ability, what you've done so far. You know, I once heard a talk by Sir Johnny Ives. He was the guy that worked with Jobs at Apple. And he said, you know, they worked on their computers and all sorts of stuff. And then someone had an idea of the iPhone. The iPad. And it was two or three of them that went into a room with Jobs and worked on it. People said, what do you need something like that for? You know, you got your phone, you got your video. What do you want to bring it together for? And they conceived this very simple idea. But most people said, no, it won't be a market. It's like the story of the founder of IBM. They said, he himself actually said there may be room, what, for five or six of these things. So my recommendation is don't be limited by what you see today. You know, it's almost like Einstein. He said logic takes you from A to B, but imagination takes you everywhere. So I'm expecting great things from you because you've got that in your gut and you've got some vision there. And you, of course, have the technical capabilities.
Thank you so much, Stan. I appreciate, absolutely, and giving us all the courage and passion to move forward. And if I may ask one more question as a young CEO, you saw and you grew Henry Schein from its infancy to 20,000 Team Schein members right from now. I wanted to hear, how are you so successful in that culture, to ability to grow to that many people and is still keeping a very strong culture?
Number one lesson, it's all about people. I wish I could say I even understood what your products do. I don't. We have people that are much better with dental knowledge than me. I don't know much about dentistry. I know about dentists and I know about dental practices and what makes dentists tick and what their practices, how they need to collaborate amongst the various professions with the public, the specialties, the public, the lab, etc. And what I think is really important for any leader is to be able to work with others, to see what motivates others, to bring people together. And I think that's what it's all about. And, you know, very often, Amir, when somebody says to me, give me one lesson you can give in management. And I say, you know what? Think about the young counselor that's running a summer camp. How do you get everybody to play? That's what business is all about. Whether it's innovation on your side, it's taking those innovative ideas to our dentists, working with the dentists, shipping an order. It's all about Team Schein. And I'm sure it'll all be around eventually Team SprintRay, as you think through how to bring your people together to advance a common mission.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Stan. And
let me ask you one, if you don't mind, if I ask you a question.
Sure.
This is a question about your generation. You know, and we're talking about the United States, I don't know, somewhere around 2040, the majority of Americans will all trace our roots to the developing world, whether it's Iran or Asia or Africa or Latin America. This will be a country where the majority will be made up of minorities. So, that's number one. And number two is the majority of our customers, when they graduate, are going to be women. So what do we do to advance diversity? How do you make sure that we get diverse thoughts into any of our organizations? What's your generation going to do about it?
I mean, I was fortunate to have been seeing a lot of diversity and inclusion in our company. And that really taught us the minorities and the power of women in the leadership, how much it could grow the organization forward. And I think that's a topic to our generation is even more and more relevant and as important as we're going to the millennials. I'm part of the millennials, I guess, that generation. And also the sense of community, I would want to add to that. Diversity, inclusion, and finally community to be able to give back. It's something that our generation has it kind of dialed in the DNA.
Yeah. So I think diversity, we have to also make sure that at the end of the day, we look after the environment, because otherwise you will have a problem, but your kids for sure will have a problem. So it was great speaking with you. I look forward to watching your products mature and then new ones come, then watching them mature and connecting your technology to our platform. So Amir, thank you for the partnership, and we're ready to promote your products.
Thank you so much, Stan. It's also a privilege for us to be a partner with Team Schein, and that sense of passion and purpose definitely are similar, and we're excited about this and pushing dentistry forward.
Excellent. Very good.